Thanks, Mark. And thanks for being the MC. I'm following you, so I must be the MD. Obviously, huge pleasure to be here. You said I felt comfortable in the Hackfest. I really do. I really wish I was developing all the time, but the way Moodle's grown over the years means I'm spending a lot of time doing everything but. But it's so interesting where it's taking me, and I did want to start. First of all, I want to actually thank some of the team that's made this happen. So Gavin's thanked the sponsors already, and I won't go through that again, but thanks to them. But thanks to Gavin especially, who, if anyone knows, I guess most of you do know Gavin, and you know he's a powerhouse of handling complex situations, and so a lot of bringing this together has been Gavin. So I just want special thanks to Gavin, so thank you, man. It's really, really, really good to have you on the team. And thanks also to the other HQ people, especially Michael Durratt, who's been in the program, who Michael's over there, and everyone involved in the program helping with that. And Mary and Helen and David Mudrack and Juan and everyone else who I may have forgotten who've been helping out. So, very much Moodle is a very multifaceted thing with lots of people making it all happen. Before I get into the road ahead, I just wanted to give you a bit of a little story about myself. This obviously is a road, and most of you drive cars. Who drives cars here? You pretty much all drive cars. This is a view we're all familiar with, driving on the road. This is something that we all will maybe do in a car. This technology we're all using creeps into our lives, and you know, we're not supposed to use the mobile phone in the car, but it's kind of very hard to just check a message or something. So when you're sitting in a car, you're pretty much a driver, right? You're in the car, you're driving the car, you're thinking about traffic. You're thinking about police, you're thinking about your destination and how you're going to be late, and you're not thinking about, I guess, all the other things that are outside. So we're driving along in our cars and occasionally touching a mobile phone. The reason I'm talking about this is because over the past couple of years, I had a couple of run-ins. So the cops at where I live have seen me touching my phone for a few seconds. And so, unfortunately, I lost my license, right, for a few months because the points added up. So I found myself without a car and having to get to work, which is about 25 kilometres away from where I live. So I went, I was looking at solutions, I was looking at public transport, and there is a train, but the train stop from my house is 6 kilometres away, so I was looking at a 6 kilometre walk or something. So I started to think, okay, I could get a little bicycle, maybe a little fold-up bicycle, something I could just take with me to the train. And I was shopping for bicycles, and this guy said, I've got these electric bikes. I said, that's really heavy. If you're getting that on the train, you know, it's going to be really difficult. And he said, well, why don't you just go the whole way? And I went, okay. I started to think about going the whole way to work on the bicycle. And so I got this bike. It's got a battery on it. The way these bikes work, if you're not familiar with them, they have electrical assistance up to a certain speed, and they kind of cut out. So then you're on your own, and you have to pedal at speed. But they can go pretty fast, and that really gives you a boost to travel long distances. I bought a nice Moodle helmet, and I started riding to work. Now, when I started riding to work, I just wore my work clothes, so, you know, wearing long pants and really just like I would be at work with a helmet. And I'm going down a road like this. So this is now my road ahead. I'm on this bike path. And the bike path, how many people here are cyclists? How many people cycle? That's really cool to see. So we've got just like half the people here cycle. So now I've cycled before, obviously I had a mountain bike and I cycle occasionally with the kids and just for fun, but I'd never sort of undertook it as a journey, as a commute before. So I'm now on this bike with my bright orange helmet, barreling down this road, and I'm loving it. I'm really loving it. And so I start looking into sort of apps and things that are around. And how many people will hear something called Strava? I could see about 20 people or so. Now, there are many, many, many apps for cycling, for all exercise things. And I looked at a few, and I just actually stumbled on this one. It just seemed to be something that was pretty well made. And it does GPS tracking of your journey and so on. And I discovered when I got into it that it's like the de facto app that a lot of professional cyclists use, a lot of cyclists use. And it has some interesting features in it, like after you've done a journey, you can see all the other people who were on the same journey, the people you passed, the people you were following. And so it becomes this community of people who start connecting up. And because I'm going pretty fast down this road, a lot of cyclists like to get in behind me into my slipstream. So I've got these guys behind me, and then when they finish their journey, they say, oh, I had an exciting bike chase with this e-bike on the way to work. And I go, well, I'm glad I could help your speeds, you know. And so we start chatting, and, you know, there's this community in there. And it gets quite interesting, and I start getting a little addicted to seeing if I can beat my scores. So I'm on this road, this bike path along the train, and the beauty of this, of being a cyclist, is you're not worrying about traffic, you're not worrying about police, you're not worrying about anything really, but you're just enjoying this road, and you get this mild, low-grade adrenaline rush with the speed and dodging trees and other traffic and racing other bikes and so on. And so then you start feeling, as you push the envelope, you start feeling wind. Wind is the enemy of the cyclist. You have resistance, constant resistance. You're feeling the weather, you're feeling the temperature, and you're just feeling this wind. So you start thinking, oh, you know, if I want to go fast, I can't wear my work clothes. So, you know, I'm wearing my just track pants and shorts and things, but they're all flapping in the wind. So must be a reason why cyclists wear tight jerseys. So I get myself a jersey and I'm going, whoa, I can feel the difference. There's this amazing difference of less resistance. So I go, oh, those shorts, I don't know. You know, cyclists, you look at cyclists, and as a driver, you see cyclists and they look like some alien beings the way they dress, right? And you're going, really? Lycra? You know, you've heard the term mammal, a middle-aged man in Lycra. And you look at them and you go, yeah, that's not for me. But then I got to the point where I thought, well, I'll just give it a try. And then pretty soon I'm buying iPhone holders and a new bottle and things to hold my luggage and so on. So like now I'm like looking like this, right? So, and I'm barreling along, shaving seconds off my journey every morning, right? But I'm really feeling the health benefits. I'm starting to feel a lot more healthier. I'm starting to, you know, I feel a lot brighter. I feel better at work. Everything's sort of really improving. So you get this cycle of addiction. So I kind of noticed that at some point I became a cyclist. And I assumed that role. I found, actually, as a cyclist, that when I wasn't on a bike, I missed it. When I got a lift to work sometimes in a car, I was like, oh, this is such a drag. I could be out there on my bike. Even on the weekends, I just started to go for rides for fun just because, you know, 2 days without my bike was too much. So I really became a cyclist. And it's interesting how we all have these roles. We all have so many little roles, then you become something for a while. I'm sure many of you probably could identify with a lot of these things here. You know, you're voters. So you get into, you know, when you vote, you move into becoming a voter at some point where you actually start paying attention as an adult to what the politics of what's going on, and you have to make a decision. So you've got this, you start becoming a voter, you start having discussions with people about politics, you start thinking about it. What are your politics? Mathematician or a home renovator or a parent or a pet owner, all these things. And so I've been thinking and reflecting a lot about this process of being something. At what point do you become a role? Do you start calling yourself that role? It's very interesting, on Twitter profiles, a lot of people will list 4 or 5 or 6 roles that they have become. But we all have, you know, many more than that. And this is not a new concept, and it's a fairly obvious concept, but I think it's very interesting to think about learning, not in terms of memorizing some content or in terms of even simply competencies, but this notion of being a doctor or being an engineer or being anything, that you feel it. This goes back to Plato. Plato talked about being and becoming, and in philosophy it's a very staple subject. But I think it's something that, as educators that we are, we need to think in those terms of our students and ourselves, of how do we help them be something, whatever it is. What do your learners want to be? And how can we help them internalize all the facts and the knowledge and the different little things that make that up? You internalize it, so, you know, when you are an engineer, you're not constantly thinking of, you know, your Stats 101 course and so on from university. You've internalized that. You just apply it when necessary. How do you help your students become that thing? So I think it's about thinking about things from an experiential point of view, this experiences of how you help somebody be something, is to give them those experiences, then choose the tools. If you're starting with Moodle or any other tool out there, it's the wrong thing to be doing, for sure. Yes, you need to understand what tools can do, but you can't start there, you know, if you really want to have an effective course, I think. You find and you use the appropriate tools, whatever they may be, from, you know, on the internet or off the internet, and you bring those together, and you build feedback loops everywhere, so that students are giving you feedback on how they're finding it, you're getting that feedback, they're getting your feedback on how they're going. And that's at basics, that's just a very core thing. Now, from that, tools on the internet. You know, I just did a very quick search for some images and dragged a bunch onto this slide. But as you know, there are hundreds and hundreds of different things, thousands of different things out there, educational technology or just communication and information technology that you can use in education. In that environment, as your tool set that's available to you, how is Moodle relevant going into the future? What makes Moodle different? I think there are some key things about Moodle that make it an important part of the landscape. The fact that it's open source, I know a lot of people don't care about it, but a lot of you do, I know, and a lot of people do. The fact that it's open source means it's kind of owned by all of us. All of us have this ability to change this software if we want to. And that leads to so many different things. A lot of you have become Moodle developers, but just the fact that it's open leads to things like ownership. If you take Moodle, you own that environment. It can become part of your institution or be owned by the teacher. You have control of it. You have the control to make it, to bend it to your will. You can make the students have all the rights of an administrator if you want to, and everything in between. Integrations. Because it's open source, a lot of people are integrating it with other things, and we have a lot more work to do in that area, but which I'll talk about. It's endless. You look at that previous slide with all those things. You know, Moodle can integrate with all those things, and a lot of people are working on those. Privacy is important, and important to me. Privacy is one of those things which you don't miss till it's gone, and it's something we should always have private options. You may not care if your data or students' data is available to a Google or a Facebook. But at some point you might, and it's too late to change your mind later. You do need to consider privacy. And open source is, last night I was talking with someone from who works with the Air Force here in Britain, and like many military organizations, they use a lot of open source because it's secure and private, ironically. And Moodle because of the education community, has a depth and a breadth that no other thing around has. If you're building a product, an edtech product, that is a single thing that you buy on the internet, it's never going to have the richness of an open source product with all its plugins and all the extensions and things that people here and elsewhere are doing. So anyway, what have we been doing lately? I get this chance to kind of say what I like up here, but we have been doing so much lately. We've really been kicking it up a notch over the past year. There is so much to talk about, in fact, that we're splitting this into two. So I'm talking about a few things. Gavin will be talking about a lot of things at the end of the conference, and we're kind of bracing the conference here. But I'm going to tell you about a few of the things and what we're up to. Moodle Cloud. It's been really exciting for us. About 7 months ago, we launched our Moodle Cloud system. It's good in so many ways. It's good for Moodle HQ to actually be doing hosting, to actually be running Moodle seriously. So we have, over 7 months, we've got to about 15,000 active Moodle sites. We're learning a lot about large-scale hosting, cloud hosting. We're learning a lot about Moodle itself. A lot of changes have already been made in Moodle from us doing this, and they'll continue to improve. There's about 40 million actions per month, so like loggable events. So there's a lot of activity. Just us having access to that activity means we can do research, we can study and learn about how Moodle's being used or not being used, and that kind of information helps us improve Moodle as well. At the same time, we're also providing a free hosting solution that people can use. Now, as you know, it's quite limited, but it's been very useful. And I'm hearing stories of people just getting a Moodle Cloud site for all kinds of purposes, it's really great to make that available. Towards the end of last year, we added this feature where you could remove the ads, because a lot of people saying they didn't like the ads, and that's fair enough. We're trying to make it pay for itself, so we had to put some ads on there, but we've got now an option where you can turn the ads off, and it's about $5.50 Australian, $5 Australian a month, which is probably nearly £0. It's like £1 or £2. So quite a few people have taken that up, and that's good. So we don't really want to be, I hate ads as much as you do, but that's just part of the model to make it pay for itself. What I want to tell you now is we're starting to expand what Moodle Cloud can do. So we are adding new packages now, which are still low-end packages, and Moodle Cloud is always meant to stay at the low end, with a package called Moodle for School. And you may think, well, Moodle is always used in schools. What we're doing with Moodle for School is taking the opportunity to customize it and craft it into something that would be more useful to a school than just core Moodle, which is actually distributed and meant to be used by universities and companies and everyone. So we've got these tiny, small, and medium packages. They still have limits. There's no customization on them. They're still very commodity packages. But out of the box, when you first get into your Moodle site, it's got this new theme that we've developed. It looks something like this. It has a lot of customizability through the interface, so you can add all kinds of panels and things on the front there's very nice, beautiful course listings, and a lot of the way it looks inside is really quite nice. So that can be, all those colours can be changed. A lot of CSS can be added if you want to, but also there's just a lot of buttons and things to push to change it, so it's pretty customizable. On top of the core Moodle, so it's a full version of Moodle, there are these plugins added to start with. So we've added a couple of things to the editor. There's a word count to count words that you're typing. There's a chemistry editor for doing chemistry and molecular formula. There is a group choice module so that students can choose a group. So you might want to have them all pick a group to do a science project or something so they can choose their own group and be with their friends. There's a level up module, which is a kind of gamification module where you gain XP, experience points, by doing things. And you can see yourself ranked against other kids, so a bit of a motivational tool, external motivational tool. Quiz Venture, which looks like this. It turns quizzes into a sort of Space Invaders game, if you haven't seen it. It was made by one of the HQ developers. The attendance module for taking attendance, and the checklist module. So hands up if you wrote one of these modules. Anyone here? I think Davo should be here. There he is. So these are modules that are just taken from the plugins database. We are, because we're using them, obviously we're reviewing them and we're maintaining them. We'll, if we find bugs, we'll post them back up to the developers and help the developers maintain them. This is just a little start. So we intend to kind of listen to what people who, anyone who takes these up, who uses the Moodle for Schools, they'll give us feedback. If they think something else really should be in that package, we'll look at it. And hopefully it'll evolve over time. So that's the Moodle for Schools. Now that's not available at this moment. It'll be there in a few weeks, sometime in April. That'll be available on there. I'll just say though, before we leave that, we're still not doing any support, right? We're not supporting people. You can get your site there. If you want support, you need to talk to our Moodle partners. And we actually make that easy in the system. We actually hook you up with Moodle partners to talk with. They can do training, they can do all the services that they do. The next thing I want to talk about we've been working on is the Moodle Users Association, and last year at this conference I talked about it as an idea that we just had was coming up. Actually, it was about 18 months ago. We're starting to cook up this idea. It's now up and running, I'm really pleased to say. It took a while last year and a lot of bureaucracy and red tape with the Chamber of Commerce, Department of Commerce in Western Australia to get it launched. A lot of paperwork, as you can imagine. Associations there, the whole law seems to be set up for like soccer clubs and tea party clubs and things like that. So getting them to understand what a Moodle user association is took a long time. but we got there and we got it up and running and it's now launched. And it's a completely separate organisation to Moodle HQ. It's its own organisation with its own committee that runs it, its own rules, and it's just beautiful from my point of view to kind of have, we've created this bird and just released it, and now we want to, well, we're just sort of interacting with it like everybody else. There's levels of membership. It's currently up to about 120 members. There's 4 gold, 5 silver, 7 bronze, 104 individuals. But this is really with almost no marketing. How many people here had not heard of the Moodle this association before today? 1, 2, 3, I can't see about 30 people. So these are people who come to a Moodle Moot. So obviously we're not getting the word out very well, so that's why I'm talking about it now. I'm not going to talk much more about it. Steve, who's here somewhere, who's on the committee, is going to be presenting about, and there's sessions later on about it to go into details. What I did want to show you, though, is a new little explainer video that we've just put together, actually, and it was only finished yesterday. So I'll play it for you, and it'll give you an idea of what the Moodle Association's about.
Moodle is the world's open source learning platform. Used by schools, universities, and organizations across the globe, Moodle makes online learning easy. People who are using Moodle have many creative ideas for making the look, functionality, and usability of Moodle even better. The Moodle Users Association is the most effective way that people from all over the world can get their ideas into Moodle. In the association, members launch their ideas and help each other to build those ideas. Together, they contribute major new features to be built in Moodle Core. People pay a membership fee to join. There are four membership levels. The higher the membership fee, the more votes you have to choose the best ideas for Moodle. Moodle Users Association members put forward their ideas. Then they work together with other members to polish them until the idea is a full proposal, ready to submit to Moodle. Members vote for their favorite proposals, and the ones with the highest votes are delivered to Moodle for development. Each successful proposal that the Moodle Users Association members vote on is developed by Moodle HQ developers into a new feature, tested, and released into Moodle Core. Anyone in the world has it and can use it. A feature by the people, for the people, thanks to the efforts of the members of the Moodle Users Association. Moodle Users Association. Coming together to design the next Moodle.
Quick test, does that sound all right? Is that, yeah, that's, what was her accent? Did anyone guess? We said you can't sound Australian, you can't sound British, you can't sound American. So she's kind of gone for something in the middle. I think it sounds international. So yeah, so that's the explainer video that'll be on the front page and around the place. And Steve will have a session later on about that. I think there's a meeting also as well. Moodle itself. The last version we released, major version, was Moodle 3. Now, usually when you hit a big milestone like that, numerically, it means very big changes. And I hope you noticed that this didn't. It wasn't scary like Moodle 2. It was a very smooth upgrade. There were still quite a lot of interesting things in there. There's my kids. Some of you may have met a couple of years ago when they came to Edinburgh. They say hi, by the way. So I'm not going to talk much about Moodle 3 because there's a lot of stuff with the release notes and things that came out about that. But I just wanted to, you're probably interested to hear what might be in Moodle 3.1. There are so many things coming into Moodle 3.1 that you could regard it as a much bigger release than the 3.0. And there's some major things landing that the community's been asking for and that I've wanted and you've wanted for a decade, right? Some big-ish things. Unfortunately, I can't demo a lot of this stuff to you. A lot of it's in development. The user interfaces are not finished, and there's a lot happening. But there is a place where you can go and look at it. I'll show you later. So there's competency-based education, the support for competencies. You know, Moodle, I don't really usually call it a learning management system or a virtual learning environment, for that matter. I usually just call it a learning platform. But VLEs and LMSs, they usually have some way to track learning, funnily enough. And in Moodle, we have not had that concept until now. It hasn't seemed to be a major difficulty we've got by, but a lot of people have added or they have other ways to add that functionality. So it was time to get something into core for tracking that this person knows this thing or doesn't. So it's a huge project. It's been in development for about a year, and that's coming very soon. It's been obviously guys at HQ, but also working with the University of Montreal, and quite a group of people, probably some of you here, who've given feedback on it. But it's really coming together very well. So it means that in Moodle now we have these core concepts of learning alongside users, courses, enrolments, and things like that. There are default interfaces for that information, but it's built so that developers, if they don't like how that's managed, can add their own plugins and build on top of it, but still use the same information. So we're all compatible. The second thing is one-page assignment grading. So actually seeing the thing that you're grading and doing rubrics or assigning grades to it on the same page. There's improvements with LTI, quite significant ones. It's now really easy to add LTI tools, both at a system level by the administrator, so that teachers can use those learning tools that are apps, if you like, elsewhere on the internet, or the teachers themselves can add them directly, and we've made that a lot easier. But the more exciting thing is we've now got LTI publishing inside Moodle by default as well. Now, this has existed as a add-on plugin by Juan Lieber, who's sitting down the front here, who works with us on leading the mobile team. But getting that into core means we can make it an integral part of how Moodle works. And it means you can do things like have a course in one site, publish it as an activity in another site, or in another system. It doesn't have to be a Moodle site. And it allows us to really mix and match these activities and courses between systems. Global search. Moodle has now had a global search in core all this time, and it now does. You can now search and get a text search with Boolean and all the nice stuff right across all your courses and so on. There's in-place editing. So it's very annoying in Moodle how often you have to go into a form to change something and then go back. So what we've been starting to do is make it so that if you see a heading, you click on it, you type the new heading, and it's done. You don't leave the page. And that's been already added across a lot of headings and section titles and things like that, and it'll slowly permeate all over Moodle so that you haven't got that as reloads. There's been grade performance fixes, so when you change large grade books, there's some bad bugs with those very large universities and institutions that have slowed the grade book down. It's been a lot of hard work to improve those things. User disguises, I think, is going to land for 3.1. This issue in the tracker is number 1,075, I think. We're now up to something like 55,000 in the tracker. So this one comes from the dim, dark past, probably like 2004 or something, and it has a lot of votes on it. But it enables you to have an anonymity in forums. You can post under a pseudonym or under a role name. Back to roles. You may want to post, maybe you're having a bit of a simulation in your forum, and one student is going to be the manager, and one student is going to be a doctor, another student's going to be whatever, and they interact under their pseudonyms as an educational exercise. So that's being built as a mechanism that can apply to all modules. I think it's probably just going to be in the forum initially, but it will eventually spread to all modules, so any activity can be using anonymity. There's a lot of use cases for anonymity. There are some courses which are very sensitive. They're discussing, maybe it's abuse or something like that, and people do not want to reveal to each other who they are so they can operate anonymously. Nicer confirmations. It looks like a small thing, but it's quite significant. Again, with the forms, a lot of when you're posting on a forum, you have your form, you type in your post, and you hit save, and it goes to a screen which says your post has been saved, and then you continue to the next step. That confirmation screen is now gone. So now what happens is when you post, it's straight back onto the discussion page, and that confirmation message is now like a little green thing at the top. an overlay. So it just takes another step out. It just makes the whole journey of traveling around Moodle a lot shorter. You can download all folders as a zip. There's a new search function on a server folder repository. So if you have a folder on the server that contains a lot of files, and that's one of your repositories, you can now search it for things, which makes it a lot more useful. Pinned discussions. I was personally against this feature for a long time, but it happened anyway, so it just goes to show. A lot of people wanted it. So you can, a particular discussion in a forum, you can now pin, and it's always at the top. There's improvements to the feedback module. It's been tidied up. There's some new stuff to do with course meta links. So when you're managing meta courses in Moodle, there was actually something that disappeared from in Moodle 2.0, which now is back. Which helps you manage meta. So those of you using meta courses, they're going to be a lot more easy to manage now. There is a recycle bin. This is actually the first Moodle User Association project. The first round of the Moodle User Association voted on a number of things they wanted to see, and this was the one that was chosen. We've now taken it. So this is is the author of this here, by any chance? Because I think she's in the UK. Maybe not. I should have done my research. But so someone in the community wrote this module, and what it enables you, what it gives you is that when you delete an activity in a course, or in fact when you delete whole courses, it takes a backup of them and stores them transparently in the background in a recycle bin. And they stay there for about 7 days. And at any time, you can go back into there and just go undelete, and it comes back. And it's all very transparent. There's no difficulty, just feels like a trash can or a rubbish bin or a recycle bin. That's not a very international word. Our part was to take that module, do a few cleanups to it to make it suitable for core, and it's now a core feature. So that's the first thing from the MUA. There'll be many, many more to come, I hope. There's lots of other things in 3.1. I'll give you a very quick look at what competencies looks like. This is actually very early interfaces for managing competency frameworks and competencies. We've just commissioned a usability review, and we have a massive report. The guys are going through that now, and so we're improving this interface further before the release. But it is designed to support competence. You may have a competency framework that is set by a government authority or an industry body. You can now import those, and you can connect them up with courses, and students are basically proving themselves against those things. We've been looking at use cases ranging all the way from primary schools, high schools, universities, corporate situations. So we're trying to make it apply to all of those. So it's sort of independent. The other thing I could show you a bit of an early screenshot of is the grading interface. So on one side, you've got the documents being graded in the assignment. There is a new backend to the assignment which will convert a wide range of document formats, including like office documents, even text documents, into a PDF, into this system, so that you can then scribble all over them and put comments. And this works on tablets as well. So you could grade them on that side. And on the other side, you've got your actual rubrics or setting the total grade of things. This interface is also getting a lot of overhaul still, so this is not final at all, but you're getting a taste for what's coming up. If you want to play with them, you go to prototype.moodle.net. There's some installs there of these individual features, as well as information on how to give feedback, so you can give us comments on the tracker or on the forums. And, you know, we'll be working really hard on these over the next month, few weeks to polish them up and get them ready for the release. Just as a brief thing, our priorities from Moodle HQ's point, let's say my point, of you. Our priorities in general are to work on the bigger things. So going forward after 3.1, there is a plans for a new default theme with no blocks and using Bootstrap 4. So very much an overhaul of Moodle's default interface to make it look really, really nice out of the box. This involves a lot of navigational elements and things. We've been working on this for quite some years, but I think it's all coming together and it'll be really, really, really ready over the rest of this year. We're working on activity module overhauls, so just tackling whole activity modules, because a lot of them need a bit of an update and a polish, the database module, glossary module, the wiki, and giving them a good overhaul. We're looking at easier integrations with other systems, so making Moodle integrate well with Google Apps, with Office 365, with all those, even Apple Classroom. These other systems out there for managing users and so on devices, but also the many other there's many integrations with other open source products and services to make Moodle just work very well with them. There's a whole range of those, and they're all in various stages of development and thought. Lastly, and not least at all, is very strong mobile support. You probably know mobile use has surpassed desktop use of the internet. In the future, most of our internet is on mobile devices, if it isn't for us already. So Moodle has to work. So that's a big focus for us, is making the Moodle mobile app very capable and making Moodle itself work very well in any mobile situation. However, those are just our priorities, and what our overall roadmap, our road ahead, if you like, is driven by three things now. We have three roadmaps. So the Moodle Users Association is going to be feeding us specifications. They're going to say, this is what we want you to make, and we're going to do it. The Moodle partners and all the clients of them, which number many thousands, they also are setting a roadmap, and they'll be giving us things that they think are priorities to work on. And then in the middle, we've got Moodle HQ itself, which is filling in all the gaps. We're looking at some of the bigger issues. We're looking at the very small issues and fixing bugs that no one else would do. And we're just filling all the gaps, holding it all together, and together we're all driving the roadmap forward. Quick shout out to all the partners, the UK and IE partners, who I think are all here. So say hi to them if you see them. And I think all together, we're all cycling down this road together. I know that's a very terrible Photoshop job. I think we're actually picking up speed. The developments in the last year have been probably more than the previous 2 years, and I think the things coming up this year are going to be even more. So I'm really excited by all the things that are happening. There's a lot of things I haven't told you about. Gavin's going to talk about them as well later on. But I think together we're moving forward. So I'm really, really happy to be here. I'd love to talk with you all. Let's see if we can do it individually, each one of us, over 2 days. Maybe I should set up a booth. I don't know. Yeah. I'm around. Is there any questions, any thoughts from anyone? I'm dying to type. He really want to try out this foam ball thing. There's a chance. Nope.
They're all tight.
It's all explained.
Yeah. Oh, here. There's Tim.
Tim.
Not really a question, it's actually, I just want to criticise your last slide, where you showed the three strands feeding into Moodle.
Yep.
Because I think you missed an important part there, which is actually Moodle HQ goes on working really hard to make it easy for Moodle users all around the world to contribute the things they want.
Yes.
And so the kind of integration team taking and all the other HQ developers who peer review fixes and give feedback. So contributions come in from all around the world. There's discussion to make sure they fit well into what's there. But I think you said, you know, that some of the big things Moodle HQ is tackling, that's because a lot of the little things get done by individual developers out there fixing the things that matter to them, which is how open source works. But
absolutely,
that's we haven't lost that.
It's the critical part, absolutely. I wasn't maybe clear enough about that, but where our part is all the stuff we have been doing up till now. Everything in the tracker, everything on Moodle.org, and all of those things. The reason for the other two thing, the other two parts of this roadmap are that if someone in the forum says, or in a tracker issue says, wouldn't it be great if Moodle had this? And a lot of people go, yeah, that would be great. But it's going to take one developer, you know, it's like 2 years of development to do, right? Or a team of developers several months to do. It's, well, who's paying for that, right? So it's that's always been my issue, not issue, my problem to solve is how do we get these things actually paid for? And so these other two parts are the ones supporting a lot of that. The partners, obviously, providing a lot through their royalties, the Moodle Users Association now from memberships, and yeah. So altogether, it makes everything very sustainable. But I will stress it again, if it wasn't already clear enough, that Moodle is an open source project first and foremost and centrally. And the whole point of everything else is to provide the world with an open source product that is fully capable. And that's really, that's our mission. Yeah. Bit of pressure to catch that, isn't there, Gavin?
it's more pressure than
Nick's really happy.
Yeah, right.
I'm really glad to hear that the developer community is still really important. But I was wondering for the Moodle Users Association, so how transparent is that? Can we see what's going on there or what's being decided?
So it is necessarily slightly private because otherwise there would be little need to be a member, perhaps. So, however, a lot of the discussions about things going on in there are actually out on the tracker or in the Moodle forums or in the usual places. So what the Moodle User Association is often doing is saying, hey, this thing that has just been floating around unfinished for a while, let's get it done. And so they're just, you know, so a lot of what they're doing is actually just taking on those projects that were out there. They're in the track already. I think that will be the major mode of operation. It's not meant to be a secret place where they decide on things. It will be very open.
Okay.
Next to you, Bass, maybe, before you throw it.
Someone.
Hi. I'd like to know whether you've considered crowdsourcing a kind of a make it happen list where the whole community could contribute small amounts. I mean, the Moodle Users Association is a more organized idea around that, but maybe, you know, literally something that would be really, really popular among the user community. Everybody could just contribute a little bit. And if I can just add one more question, the thing that I think would be one of the most kind of groundbreaking things is for Moodle to become a place where it is so easy to create online content, you know, intuitively. And so if you can copy and paste a picture in, as you can do in Google Slides, and it just creates the image. All those kinds of things that make it easy for people to create content, bringing in whatever they want to, and making, instead of links to, you know, PDFs, etc., etc. I think that would get the creativity really pumping? Thank you.
Thank you. It's great having a microphone. I need to repeat the questions. There's on your first point about crowdsourcing, yes, the Moodle User Association actually is effectively crowdsourcing, but with organisation. We have tried unstructured crowdsourcing before. It doesn't work. We ask for donations. We get very, very little. We've said who will fund these projects. Nobody comes forward. It hasn't worked in the past. So that's why the Moodle User Association, really, because if that had worked, we wouldn't have needed the Moodle Users Association. Yeah.
The sort of individual membership, there's no group over that. Anyone can do individual membership. I think it's a little bit of Australia, so it's not a huge amount.
It's like £2. Yeah.
I was going to make the same point. I think it's approximately £50 UK, and if you can't, for an individual, and if you can't cough up £50 towards the future of Moodle, you should be mildly embarrassed. There's one criticism I've got, and my very first comment was about the Moodle Association, is I want merchandising. I want badges. I want to be at an event like this. I want people to see and go, ooh, him or his organisation has paid up and he's a bit more special than the rest of you. So that's just my suggestion.
Don't tell me, tell the Moodle Users Association, because it's nothing to do with us anymore. So Hideto is here, Steve is here. Is anybody else here a member of the Moodle Users Association? Cut some hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's 10 people here. Yeah, it's true. Probably need some T-shirts and I'll just throw that in your court. Hideto is actually already wearing a badge. He's an expert in this area. So, yes, the points of the Moodle Users Association is that as a member, you have some skin in the game, so to speak. You know, you have incentive to participate, rather than, and it connects that with actually getting things done. And you know things will happen. Unlike on Kickstarter, you don't, for example. Yes, hello.
Martin.
How are you, Peter?
Maybe you can clarify what is going on with Totara. I am confused about what I read about it, and I don't see really the position of the headquarters. I see partners who are Totara partner and Moodle partner, so
yep.
I'm curious to hear your observations and positions.
Well, so Totara is 90% Moodle. It's just Moodle with some extra work on top. They've said now that they are not interested in staying in synchronization with Moodle, so they've effectively forked as of last year. Our developers still talk with some of their developers about common issues inside the Moodle tracker, but apart from that, there's not a lot of relationship. As a product, it does suit a certain need in certain working environments. And so a lot of our Moodle partners are also Totara partners so that they can use that as a solution, and that's totally fine. From my point of view, it's still a Moodle, still a derivation of Moodle. There's some interesting things going to happen in the future later this year that I won't talk about yet, but that we're going to be doing in that area. But at this point, that's about it. Yeah. So we're not. I'm not talking with Totara leadership very often. Yeah.
One last question, please.
Last question, and then is it coffee time?
Yeah, of course. Always coffee time.
Excellent. Over here. That's a big throw.
Michael?
It's like a real quarterback.
I let
throw.
Michael do that one, yeah?
Okay.
That's a three-pointer for me. I was never good at basketball.
Thank you. Just back to the Moodle Users Association. Have you any plans for corporate membership? I've no idea how I'd get that past our procurement people, but...
Don't talk to me. Talk to... I don't think the organisations are... They don't say what type of organisations, the memberships. Okay. So...
Okay. No, I mean, like a university joining as a organisation, so organisational membership.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So there are organisational level members. There is only one restriction on membership only, and that's that if you do Moodle services, that you can't be a member. That actually means Moodle partners cannot become members. It means anyone doing Moodle services can't be a member. And that's to reduce any potential confusion with the Moodle partner scheme. Commercial Moodle services. Well, any Moodle services, actually, because it's a fine line. So, yeah. But anyway, talk to the association if there's any problems there. I'm willing to help you.
Well, come along this afternoon and I'll tell you all about it.
What time is it, Steve?
It's 17:45. I've just tweeted it.
All right.
And it's Glad Suites too, so yeah, might need to move to a different room off the sound of it.
Well, look, on that note, thank you very, very much. And I'm looking forward to chatting with you and have a nice couple of days. I want to see lots of these presentations. I'm very keen. So thanks. Cheers.